Yeah. So, I'm a big fan of SpaceX because they're doing such cool stuff, and they're a big fan of Mars, so I got interested in Mars, and the more I listened to and read about what people were saying, the more I realized they're not thinking it through. They're saying there's going to be too much oxygen in the atmosphere when there's nitrogen in the Martian atmosphere for the taking. So, anyway, on Mars, the day is very similar to Earth, land area is very similar to Earth. Sunlight almost half of Earth, gravity about a third, which is kind of cool. We were talking about low gravity and what cool things can happen in low gravity. Transportation costs, if SpaceX works out, $500,000 a person, supplies at $1 per gram. Remember that. These are pictures of things that are basically they cost less to import than to buy on Earth. Yeah, if SpaceX does that. CHON, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen. These are the most important things for plastics and for people, and they're all available on Mars, readily available. So most of what we need on Mars is already there. Energy is going to cost less than $10 a watt, going to cost about 10 cents a kilowatt hour, believe it or not, not counting the labor on Mars to install it. Housing, take a plastic envelope, strap it around to keep the pressure in. Keep it flat with internal bracing and $10 a square foot, $100 a square meter. Oh, and then blow dirt on it. I say blow, throw dirt on it. Dirt protects against the radiation that's on Mars, protects your materials, protects you from temperature extremes and meteorites. Lifting the dirt is trivially cheap in terms of energy cost. So basically, you live in a giant dirt-covered dome. How giant can it get? Well, basically as giant as you want, since it's basically a pressure vessel, it's efficient at any size. And this is a real building, it really exists in Japan. You can get sunlight in by bouncing it through mirrors or tubes that don't let the radiation in, because radiation goes straight and sunlight can be reflected. And so then you grow as many plants as you want. And algae goldfish. Now, I keep talking about radiation. Okay, radiation is a problem, yes. Your cancer risk will increase by a few percent going to Mars. That's probably reasonable given what I'm going to say later. Communities are probably going to be individual buildings spaced out fairly widely. Well, urban or suburban density. Because you're going to want tunnels or hallways between them covered with dirt, that's going to cost something. Healthcare is probably going to be pretty much like Earth. Remember, you can import any medicine you need because it's not that expensive. If you can get people there, you can get the medicine there for the people. Earth is less than an hour away by telecommuting, so you can get all the medical advice you need. In addition to healthcare, there's all sorts of other jobs available on Mars. You're not going to be bored, but you're not probably going to be overworked. Ask me again about the robot arm in the Q&A. And you can bring money into Mars. Did this stall? No, okay. Yes, it did stall. That is different from that.
Why was that happening?
Oh, maybe it was the crown cast there.
Oh.
Crown cast.
Oh. All right. Okay. So you can go on from this slide and get the next slide.
Isn't it?
Okay. So you can earn Earth money on Mars by doing scientific research that they'll pay for. You can do software engineering. Remember, time lag, communication lag is less than an hour, and software is very high value per bit. If you can find gold on Mars, it's worth exporting it back to Earth. You can export reality TV. At least a few people can. That's not sustainable for a million-person colony, which is why I put a question mark. But yeah, if you figure that, say, a tenth of people on Mars are working Earth jobs for Earth pay at, say, $100,000 a piece, then that's $10,000 per person per year, and that's enough to import 10 kilograms per person per year. And the next slide, if it ever comes up. All right. This is sort of a budget of things you can import. You can increase your energy budget by a kilowatt a year. You can import several thousand aspirin pills. This is per person. You can import a third of a new room. Okay, this the rest of this is speculation. I'm thinking that for more than 1,000 people, you're probably going to want to distribute the social structure and have distributed economic units making their own choices. That way you avoid the tendency to central plan. Governance, it is going to be a little bit tight on Mars. So, yeah, no, pretty exciting. There are going to be some community resources to administer. Now, here's why I said it might be worth an increased cancer risk. Everyone coming to Mars has an automatic 6-month quarantine. Also, there are not very many animal vectors, no mosquitoes, we assume. And basically, you could be healthier on Mars than on Earth, on average. The healthcare for the extreme conditions, they might kill you in 2 years instead of 5. But and finally, the speculation looks to me like we can do human flight on Mars if we get a big enough building to fly in. Yeah. Because it takes less, it takes about a third of the energy to fly on Mars as it does on Earth. And humans can, with difficulty and really extreme engineering, can fly on Earth. On Mars, it would be fairly straightforward.
Cool. So,
there are many, many resources that I Googled to put this together. Here are some of the coolest or more idiosyncratic ones.
Can you tell me a little bit more about that robotic arm?
Sure, I can tell you about that robotic arm. So that robotic arm I met at Maker Faire this past weekend, and it weighs 6 kilograms. Most of that is 3D printed from plastic that could be made on Mars. So, and it costs $3,000 on Earth, and so it's one of the things that costs more to buy than to ship to Mars. Again, assuming SpaceX's transportation numbers are real. And it can pick up a kilogram at a range of a meter and place it with 2/1000ths of an inch or 50 microns accuracy. So basically it can do a lot of the fiddly assembly tasks needed to do manufacturing to support a Mars colony. For example, you ship bare solar cells, then you need to solder them all together into panels. Well, the robot can probably do that. Yes.
Assuming SpaceX and the other innovators in that space are successful, and assuming the trends in technology and whatnot continue at the incredibly rapid pace that they seem to be going on, how far away do you think putting the population onto Mars of any significant number, like, you know, more than 10 people or whatever, how far away do you think that actually is?
I'm going to pick a number out of thin air and say 2 decades.
That's pretty soon.
Wow.
Yeah.
Why?
Yeah, Ada could be.
Why?
Because basically Elon Musk wants 1 decade, and he seems to think in Mars years. I mean, if you look at his time estimates, they work fairly well if you can just call them in Mars years.
Interesting.
What do you think are, like, the top challenges people will have to overcome to make this a reality?
One, political will. Lots and lots of naysayers. It helps that we have a billionaire who personally wants the Mars colony to work.
Mm.
Two, things you don't know that'll kill you. I mean, the odds of the first colonists having a long, healthy life are not that great.
No.
The 100th colonist, the 1,000th colonist, they'll be a lot better off. Because they'll have the chance to learn from the mistakes that took out the first few. That could be overly pessimistic. Even with private funding and volunteers, you can still bet they'll be really, really careful. On the other hand, SpaceX has lost rockets. Three, there is a lot of engineering to be done. For example, Martian soil is poisonous as found. We need to find materials that are compatible with it. We need to deal with dust storms, blocking a lot of the solar energy for possibly long periods. We need to work out better manufacturing, figure out how small we can make an efficient polyethylene plant.
Hmm.
Cool.
Yeah.
Hmm.
Other questions?
How do we know nobody's already there?
How do we know no one?
Isn't Matt Damon up there?
Yeah.
Do we need to save him?
Certainly no one from Earth is up there. We would know if someone had launched a rocket big enough to put a human on Mars, and also we'd have picked up the radio traffic. We can be quite sure that there's no intelligent technological life on the surface of Mars, because we've looked at it with telescopes from pretty close up. There could very well be...
With rovers from the surface.
That's also close up, but it's only seeing a very small
true.
Part of it.
That's
if you sent a robot to Earth, it probably wouldn't see a human.
Okay, that's a good point.
Oh, yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
On the reality TV topic, there was that company that was talking about, you know, like people applying and then they were going to fund the expedition by the reality TV royalties or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Did that totally collapse yet? I assume it's going to, if it didn't.
I don't know. I haven't looked at it.
Okay.
At any rate, that's something that would only work once or twice.
Yeah.
I mean,
I
although Survivor has a lot of seasons.
They lost all their money.
That's true.
Yeah.
So
Survivor Mars.
Yeah.
So, there's a lot of space plastics in this scenario, because plastic is lighter and all that stuff. I mean, in all of this calculation, is there also, like, how to deal with recycling the products or the waste?
Oh.
Or having safe things that might break down and be a health hazard later on? Like, are we going to deal with the same problem we have here?
Well, some plastic has chlorine in it. A lot of plastic doesn't have chlorine in it. Some plastic has plasticizers in it. Polyethylene is carbon and hydrogen. So basically, if you have a gas stove in your house, you're putting carbon and hydrogen into the air already. And recycling of thermoplastics, you melt them down. With people living in an enclosed space, you can bet they'll be fairly careful about what they put into the air.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, that's a good idea. Just put a big bag over.
Thank goodness we're calculating this new idea.
Yeah. You also talked about the putting soil on in order to keep out radiation. Is that that's assuming all using all, everything that already exists on Mars, or is that also work? Okay.
That would be digging up Mars soil with something very much like a snowblower, and basically just lofting it over with almost no atmosphere and one-third gravity. It's very easy to throw loose dirt in a nice arc and have it land on top of your dome right where you want it. So you don't need conveyor belts like you would on Earth to put dirt on top of your building. You inflate your dome, the pressure supports enough dirt for all the radiation shielding you need, and then you just run a snowblower around it and blow dirt on it.
How, I don't know if this is a silly question, but if there's
no such thing.
Okay, that's no such thing as silly questions. How does human life get all the nutrients they need to continue surviving? Like, especially when it's further away from the sun.
Good question. So, vitamins probably we get in pills. Or in food that we grow on Mars. Minerals, if we don't find them on Mars, we import them. That's an early slide. I said the human body is over 96% Chon. So that means that I weigh like 100 kilograms. 4 kilograms, $4,000 is enough to import the nutrients for a me-sized person, the trace nutrients.
And
that's so cheap.
Sorry if everybody else already knows the answer to this, but what's SpaceX?
Oh.
I don't know. You guys
no,
are,
my
I
bad.
Don't know
my bad. Okay,
yeah.
SpaceX is a rocket company that is very innovative. They're making rockets cheap enough that China is worried about whether they can compete, and that was before they started routinely landing the first stage back on a barge or on at the launch site.
Which
and
is literally the coolest thing that has ever happened in the history of
space.
Yeah.
like the U.S., China, Europe, the Russians, everybody spent billions of dollars and decades to try to land a rocket, and like SpaceX just did it.
Is it
routine yet?
Landing is pretty routine.
They're doing pretty good.
Reusing them, they've only done it once so far, but it worked. And they got it back again.
And the same one.
The same
one came and landed again.
Yeah, so the same booster went up, came back, went up, came back again. And the video is like I'm getting goosebumps thinking about it, literally.
Because the part that's really expensive, and you just said this, but the part that's really expensive is
the first stage.
Yeah, it's the first stage.
Yeah. So basically this giant rocket that's, I forget how many stories tall, just comes down and settles down and lands right on the bullseye, and there it is.
On the bullseye of a platform that's floating in the ocean.
Yes.
That's automated, that doesn't have any humans on it, because it drives itself, because they built a self-driving boat in the meantime. Like, nobody even talks about that part.
It's
like,
cool.
So who are these people?
Yeah, I was going to say, who runs SpaceX? Who owns it?
So Elon Musk.
I was going to joke about that.
That's what he's doing in his spare
time. Yeah. It's the real life Iron Man. Like, they actually, the movie was partly inspired by him. And I think he had a cameo in it. And he's a co-founder of PayPal, one of the companies that merged to form PayPal. Tesla, if you've heard of Tesla cars, that's his. Hyperloop is his idea.
Three was Solar City.
Solar
he was
City.
The investor there.
Which is now Tesla.
Which now, then he had Tesla buy them. And then the new thing is the Neuralink that he's doing. I forgot.
Oh, yeah, AI also.
And the tunnel.
Is it safe to trust Elon Musk?
If he says that something can be done, it's pretty safe to assume it can be done. If he says it'll be done in 2 years, it could easily be done in 4 or 5 years.
Is he trying to save the world?
Yeah.
He is trying to save humanity, which is not quite the same. He's trying to give us a backup.
Is he trying to be king of Mars?
I don't think so.
He wants to go to Mars at the end, but he doesn't want to be one of the first travelers. He said
that.
He said literally, the first several people will probably.
But not on landing.
Yeah.
So yeah, I think he does probably want to go to Mars himself, and but no, I don't think he's setting himself up to be king of Mars. He's already king of like 3 or 4 companies.
That's true.
And I don't think Mars wants a king. I mean, kings are an extravagance. And I think for living on Mars, even with the giant indoor beach building that is quite possible in a colony of 1 million people, but there will still be a fair amount of economizing to do and hard work to do for a while. Especially since as soon as we figure out how to make self-sustaining cities, the birth rate's going to go up because people are going to go, hey, my descendants can have a big chunk of Mars if I pop out enough descendants.
Oh, God.
Speaking of which.
Your grandchildren.
Hey,
yeah.
Are going to own Mars.
Well. Going to own a piece of it. Yeah. Yes.
I'm just thinking, like, in terms of U.S. budget, because that's been in the news a lot recently.
Oh, yes.
If the budget was not going towards military, and, you know, military has a huge chunk of it, hundreds and hundreds of billions of dollars per year,
mm-hmm.
or whatever, how much faster could we get there if we were spending money on this kind of scientific research? And
I'm going to pull another number completely out of the air and say a factor of 3 faster.
That's a lot faster.
Yeah. It's not like we could get there in 2 years
even with
unlimited money.
There's just a lot of work that has to
be. Yeah, there's a lot of R&D. If we didn't have to worry about crashing rockets, like if we could build rockets that were allowed to blow up, we still wouldn't want to blow up most of the rockets, because that would be taking out pads right and left, and pads take time to construct, as we know, sadly.
Yeah.
So there would still be a need for careful engineering, there'd still be a need for incremental testing, but if we were allowed, for example, if Elon Musk had been able to test landing on barges just for the heck of it, rather than having to make it a secondary mission to paying customers, he could probably have shaved 2 or 3 years off his schedule, I'm guessing, because he just didn't have that many tests per year.
But it was the way to be sustainable. That's like their whole model.
Yeah.
SpaceX's model is to get satellites into space for like cheaper than anybody else can do it.
Yeah.
So they make this like crazy profit and they plow all those profits back into researching how to get to Mars.
Right. So if someone just suddenly gave SpaceX $100 billion a year, we would probably see them flying every 2 weeks whether they had a cargo or not.
Right.
And we would see them building their giant rocket. Basically, they'd be able to build more models and more partial models.
Yeah.
Don't they have like a crazy wait list to get to go up in orbit? Like, I thought they had like thousands of people that were ready to pay the like.
I don't think. think that's their business model. You may be thinking of Virgin Galactic.
Yeah.
And possibly it's Blue Origin.
Yeah.
Virgin
Galactic. That's the
yeah.
Is that a real thing?
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
It's like $10,000 or $20,000 to fly to go orbit the Earth and come back down.
No. That's millions. Orbit is millions.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Suborbital is, I think, 200,000.
To get to
suborbital.
Going straight
that's
up
thing, yeah.
And then coming straight back down.
Yeah.
20,000 gets you a ride on the Vomit Comet.
Sounds great. All right. Let's see.
Yeah.